I'm a freelance developer and have started with panorama creation. And as you know, if you're making outside panoramas, you always have to the whole sky over you, and most often there's the sun inside, and so you have lots of dynamic range to cover. And one thing I found very enjoying was that you get gradients over the sky, which are going from say a deep blue to white, and in between you have most often a cyan color, which is very non-natural. And so I search for something to get right of this, and discovered color management as a good way to get this solved, and and also the overall appearance of the images improved very much, as well as the printing. And so I came to color management and tried to improve this for the Linux workflows. I much worked on the CinePaint project. It was at the time, I think, the first open source HDR editor in 1998 or 9, about this, developed in Hollywood, or improved in Hollywood based on GIMP. And this editor was a really surprise for me to have on Linux a 16-bit capable painting engine, and could do manipulate my photos inside, as well panoramas, of course. And where I started with color management, there was some student who implemented then color management in a more professional way than I did at the time, because I was just learning programming. And based on this color management, I improved it and brought it to a major state where display profiles worked, where caching worked, and all these minor flaws which make a workflow sometimes unusable. So it's now a stable, uploaded tutorial. And based on this experience in CinePaint, I later tried to get this color management out, to make it available to other applications, and I worked close together with the OpenICC email list, where many people are together sitting to get and consensus about what color management could be looked like on Linux and open source systems. So, and Oranus is let's call it the implementation of the ideas of the OpenICC, and including my personal ones. So the main question for color management is how to get the real life colors, I hope my mouse is visible, of an natural object through all the devices we need to capture, to reproduce for instant displaying, and also for printing, and of course for exchanging over internet, and for photographic archives. To make it I always try to get color management as simple as possible, but sometimes I'm always far away from this, and so it's possibly right to tell what color management basically has to do and how it works. You get with the camera here displayed as an input device, capture of the real world, and you have practically a profile either provided by the camera manufacturer or by the or some library or some internet site, and you can use this profile to characterize the color in the captured image. You can of course calibrate in profile your camera yourself to get an own individual profile to match, for instance, a special lighting condition to reproduce very accurately some artwork. But of course, it has limitations. Spectral imaging is possibly much more adequate to this, but it can improve your workflow very much. And this camera profile will be attached to the image. Ideally, you don't see it how it works, how it happens. This possibly in the background. This would be nice. You have some database of profiles and according camera models and manufacturers and there happens some lookup and the right profile is selected and attached to the image. And this image can be displayed. You need a profile for this device, for this display device too. And these profiles are merged somehow magically in the color management engine, and you get out and transform with the application uses to convert the camera image to the display colors, and then you can see this pre-matched colors on screen. Same as for printing, so these two output devices are very close to each other. Of course, printing needs sometimes CMYK for better using the printer color space and for doing some special things with the typically 4 and more inks you have there. Well, the SOC profile for the monitor is should be somehow closely to X located, and so the profile for the printer, I think there's in CAPS some PPT field to specify the printer there, but there are also some other workflows where you get earlier the printer profile and then convert the colors and send the raw data to the device. Okay, now some more theoretical overview. The Commission Internationale d'Éclairage, I hope I could pronounce it somehow reasonably. It's an organization from lightning bulbs and from lightning equipment. It's very old, very old group, and we have early worked on specification and on research to characterize and describe human seeing, and they basically described not so much special colors, but how humans perceive color and how they can be formulated from the spectral appearance, how it can be translated to a free component-based color space. And the result is mostly known as CLHB color space and the CLXYZ color space. And these are the base for computer graphics today, and it has improved as a very robust and usable calculation base. Of course, there are more advanced and other approaches, but this is primarily what is used by the most frameworks and applications. Yeah. The next body incorporated in color on computers is the International Color Consortium, ICC, which is a conglomerate of major computer corporations like Apple, formerly Microsoft, Adobe, Xerox, and Greytech, and so on. And we obtained agreement about how to store color colorimetric information into a file format to write out and to move around between computers to attach to profiles, which is here shown. I have shown you in the bottom area the raw numbers coming out of the camera. You need to integrate some file format on the upper right side, and to get it the same meaning for the colors, you need the color profile to who described what is the file content describing. And with these three basic bricks, you get a meaningful color image. In this case, of a camera. OpenICC is it's not a body, it's more a group. I want to point out it's primarily an email list which was started by Peter Linnell from Scribus to get color people invited, not only from Linux, but also from the ICC, from Adobe, from X, and so on, to discuss about the behavior of color management on Linux. So get and this char symbol, this symbolized this for application windows, to get all applications agree upon common standards, what to do with colors, what to do with rendering, and I have shortly mentioned what can be all what shall all be coordinated in the lower right. And so many points. So now we are already at entering some more high level stuff. The color management has some requirements, as an application developer, as a backend developer, you have some requirements to a color management system, and I have listed here. These are about device profiles, getting them associated to the devices. After creation, you also must find a way to get them assigned to the according data. We have to find a way how untagged data, which is very very common for not only for internet, where it's defaulted to sRGB, but also on your computer, we have many untagged data, and in various workflows, you might decide to not use sRGB to have a default assignment to this data. You need a common rendering behavior. This is currently, I think, a very weak point in the ICC specification, but our approach is at OpenICC to define a default color rendering intent which the applications use for the normal rendering and also for the proofing rendering. Well, very nice for a color management system would be to have a switchable CMM where you can design on some control panel which one you use, or application can do this individually. ITC had the ITC consortium has written floats capable column engine and system. This would be interesting for analysis applications or for high quality output. Smart CMMs, which were recently written for the ColorSync framework based on ArgoCMS. ArgoCMS is an open source project and so primarily available on Linux. Well, it would be good to have it on Linux too. Hardware acceleration is also an interesting point to get used by the applications. And with a switchable CMM in the application, you primarily don't care about. You have your standard API, and the user does decide what is useful. Also, the application has some influence on it. Well, this would be a nice point. The last one is HDR gamut to low dynamic range tone mapping. This is something we will interface more and more as the workflows change, possibly from the history we had in the past only 8-bit images. With the appearing of the cameras, we did a large step to 16-bit color processing, and many applications support it now. And I'm expecting that we have the same. We will see the same for HDR, and HDR has currently this problem that devices don't usual. Devices like monitors don't show all the colors, all the intensities, and so you must find a meaningful mapping from the very large and non-displayable HDR values to the low dynamic range values of monitors and, of course, of printing. Now, it would be fine to have all this covered by an API. Here's a slide showing you the difficulties by the rendering intent, where you can have a decision of the user in the upper part who wants just this sample gradient, and the results can be very different depending on rendering intent, depending on the profiles involved. I think the CMM has not much influence, but it's also possible that there can be taken influence. And on the right side, the screenshot shows how it looks like an LHB image is mapped to a CMY key in the center, and you see lots of crossings of colors. And I don't think it's something desirable. And the control over this process should be go to the user. This is, as I mentioned before, something not solved in the ICC framework. As a side note, I think the Microsoft Windows Color Management System, WCS, Windows Color System, has majorly this problem as a background for its design, and I think it provides a way to handle this more apparently. So now again, a problem for which applications interface. Here's shown how colors start, how colors entrance the application. You can have vectors, image maps, fonts, and so on. And with an according profile, you can be very versatile, and you can have different color spaces, and it's very hard to get it under one hood. And so you possibly need a common sense, a common color space where you all, where you just all your blending, scaling, manipulation, and so on, inside the application, to have just one blending color space. And Akuta has the opportunity to have mixed color objects, but I think you also will use one blending space.
Yes, we blend one color space.
Yeah, and this Adeline color space is a very important very important setting in color management workflow. Now the other understanding about for the understanding of color binding, your application, if it's capable, can decide to let color management happen at various stages in the workflow. You can simply tax the color space which you have internally in your application and send it out and give it over to cups or to display. And the color matching is happening at the end of the workflow. This means near to the output device. So cups is responsible for color matching. X or something close to it is responsible for color matching, and this is what we will see enlarged by applications doing. The other extreme is you have a high profile application which want to have as most as possible control. You do all yourself, and then you want later on that no one touches your colors, and you have pretty much to X already, you have pretty much to the printing system already, and this is what we do in Cinepaint currently, and I think most other applications have only this way to handle color management at the moment. The third possibility is a mixture of these both, and it means mainly that you does the critical part of color management inside the application. You does specify rendering intent, which profiles of course involved for input and output, and possibly use some special color management engine which does not fit in the framework or you have already available in your application. And this color transformation is saved out to a device link profile, and you bypass all problems which may appear later in the workflow, and this device profile must be later applied to the image data, so you can have a small image data set, say for printing, you send a three channels image, and then later on it's exploded to say six channels in the back end, for instance in cups or in Guten Print. This was lately requested by Grim Gill, the color management author of the algorithm, and I think it's an interesting idea. We have to explore for the workflows. Yeah, and here's an overview how I think a color management system and a color management library should fit into the operating system. You see the near to the user layers on top and very very bottom lines the system close services, and in between you have the various helper libraries, the upper part for the color management system can be a color control panel where you set some options, select some profiles, assign profiles to devices and so on, visualize the profiles you have and installed on your computer, It's maybe a relatively a very thin layer where you don't expose too much, but it's important for the user interaction. The next layer is the API, which will be accessed by Cairo, Qt, and so on, to tell the column management system what it has to do and where it should do something. And the next layer is the real color management engines, which have to do the hard mathematical work. This is not necessarily inside the color management system itself. It can be modules which are living outside, libraries like LCMS, a module in Compiz for rendering in OpenGL, or other color management libraries, which then provide their capabilities to the color management system to let the color management system pass it, forward it to the applications. And the bottom layer are the output services to simply apply these color transformations. I'm not sure if it's always a good idea to have these directly accessed by a color management system. Probably it's best to have some specification to interact with them, like agreed in the OpenICC, and CAPS has taken action on it already, and so probably it's only some convention, nothing to link in. Well, now about awareness itself, about the library. It's designed, or in the recent time, designed to be an object-oriented C library to let access to as most as possible applications and other libraries, high-level libraries. It's BSD licensed. It's an open development project process. I hope to get more people involved, and with this Summer of Code, we will get more people work directly on this library. It aims at being toolkit independent in the way that it provides APIs for generating custom option panels to integrate into desktops. Its APIs are designed to become OS independent. We know all applications of the free software world are easily ported to other platforms, and where it's important to seamlessly plug in into the available color management system. This would be ColorSync and OSX and the Windows color management system. I'm not sure if you will see plugging in to other color management systems like the one from Kodak, because it's not easily accessible. The current hosting is done at my private server and an SF SourceForge. Possibly this can change to some other place which is more convenient for other developers. We will see. Well, what does the awareness color management system? In general, it's a coordination library. You will not see much mathematics involved in what it does, but it tries to get all these things which are agreed and on the OpenICC and decided into one library that you can forget it about in the application. And it exposes, of course, these decisions and this behavior, so you can individually access it and handle it yourself. But primarily, it tries to virtualize all this stuff, and so you have very easy very easy handling of color management in your application. So what it does is in step-by-step profile, looking up, searching all the paths, recursively and getting out all the profiles. It does caching of profiles and color transformations. If you have thumbnailing application with thousands of images in a folder, you cannot assign to each image a new transform. It would be very expensive from calculation time and also from memory usage. Checking of profiles is done in the library. At least I have started with it. So mentioned options for rendering intent and behavior and so on. The configuration panel is ONS comes with a sample implementation in FLDK. This toolkit is not very standard, but I think we will see other panels follow this example. It's modules, the color management, the color matching modules like SMS are DL opened by the ORANUS library. So when you link to ORANUS, you have only a few dependencies. It's actually Electra for the configuration storage and ORANUS itself. But on request, you can call into X and also in LCMS and probably some more libraries following in the future. It currently supports just what is in LCMS. This is the 8-bit, 16-bit ints and the 64-bit duples. And I hope this will change in the future. And we get where some more advanced strategy for plex preservation and for precision that we support the half, the 16-bit float type and the 32-bit float type without any, also seamlessly. And what I also want, and what I designed the APIs to in ORANUS is to later plug in tone mapping for color matching of the HDR images to the monitor and other output devices, so that you have possibly another option in the configuration panel for this kind of task, and the user can decide what he likes most, and all images are shown in this way just by awareness. Another feature which is very important for color quality assurance in the workflow is a way to get an information what is done step by step at the image. So the first conversion to editing space, the manipulations on the image, the color manipulations, and then later the last conversion to the output profile. And I'm planning to introduce some feature and have ideas about it, how to record this inside of the profiles. And it's possibly very expensive in terms of calculation and storage, but for certain cases it will be very useful, and this can be later on added to ORANUS library. You get it for free when you just adhere to the API. I'm also trying to make support. We had 1 year or more ago, I have read the question on the Krita email list about supporting OpenXL images, and it was about multi-layered images, and so I tried to do it in CinePaint, and during this I saw that that the OpenXL specification supports color layouts with blown up numbers of channels, 40, 60, and it would be nice to have support for picking out the according color channels where, and you have in the application a very easy way to tell the color management what is this strange layout, and it can and the color management system takes care about converting these colors. So it should be easily to support exotic movie industry image layouts and pixel layouts. One thing this which is not not yet very clear to me, or at least I have to research some more in user interface design for not so much the appearance, but more the technology behind this, our dynamic user interface, where a color management module can describe special options, like for instance for the smart CMM to have a slider for when the gamut mapping should be more exactly, when shall it start, and so on. And these are non-standard options which are surely will never be exposed in a control panel, and it's very hard to support on application level, because if you change a plugin, you know, you don't know what plugin is installed in the computer, and applications using a color management framework have very different needs according related to the toolkit. So it should be this dynamic user interface should be easier to write in the native toolkit, like Qt, like GTK, FLTK, and so on, or other toolkits, possibly also on the command line. And would be really important and nice to have feature, and I hope I can base most options on this on such a this design based on, let's say, XML or something like this. Well, the tone mapping framework in Arvinus is about here's the dynamic options I already mentioned. It's about designing a plugin API which has a new hierarchy for presenting to the user to tell, hey, I'm a tone mapping operator, you can use me for HDR displaying, and so the application knows when to show this filter or this operator. It would be interesting to explore which engine is capable of doing the math behind it. SMS is of course not. It's dedicated to ICC color handling. CDL is a good candidate. It's a color transform language developed at Ilm, a major movie studio in Hollywood, and the specification is close to C, and the syntax is close to C, and it aims at computing the color transforms in the GPU shader, but possibly no. I see. It was the one-dimensional engine, and we need possibly something different than this, and find out what can handle the surrounding of the image pixel to get two-dimensional operators, as tone mapping operators are usually are. Okay, and what I think would be really nice is with all this flexibility, if this can be used by other applications for very different purposes, and serves as a possibly as a general plugin API, this would if where it's interesting by other developers, probably speed up the whole development as others can add their own ideas and help in evolving with this development. In details, the history tracking is about saving the profile IDs. It's basically an MD5 checkup zone into the device link profiles. And what already is done is exporting of these device link profiles from the color management module. This is a requirement of my architecture. These device link profiles are then embedded into the output profile for later looking up and to have a place where it's found, so it's close to the image and it's very obviously to how to find it. Later can be designed tools to extract this information. Well, I could think this could be done possibly in Combits for the screen case, and you have a plugin and select some region and ask, hey, what is the profile there? And then you get out the profile and you can examine what is what color conversions were used in the process. Dynamic user interface I have already talked about, so I will skip this. Here's an API example, just an outline what I think Aranas should look like inside an application. I have omitted the options because I'm just at layouting and designing the API. Basically, you have to tell the color management system what profile is used, and you can load it from memory or use a standard profile which is taken from the user preferences. Then you have to attach it somehow to the image in memory. You can do this by creating an Aranas specific image structure. This would be something where you tell Aranas about where's the buffer, which size has it, what is the pixel layout, and assign the profile to it. And you have to wisely to use two of these images. It's then the input and the output image. These two profiles will be passed. These two image structures will be passed to the color conversion call, where you get out a structure which holds all of this information incorporated to make the color conversion, and then you simply can call run to this structure. It's a very simple call. Or you want to or you want to get out the conversion, so the output profile, and you call to the color conversion to obtain it. Basically, the output profile and the which you used for the second image, your target image, and the output profile you see very below here. This is basically the same, but in case of color tracking, it will be quite different. And so it's easy. You call the color conversion object and get it from there. Well, I hope this will be a very simple way to get default and standard color conversions right quite from the beginning. What you do is you tell about the things you know better in the application than anywhere else, but all the settings from the control panel about rendering intent you don't care about. And when you when later we kept the tone mapping inside and the color management module framework working, then you don't care about in the application, and the API does it under the hood, and it's all included. And I hope so this this API will get some more appealing then, and you can slowly move from LCMS, which is currently is a major API under Linux for color management, to this very simple kind of programming and do it in a new way. Okay, you have a question.
Yes. Does your API assume that we convert the entire image in one go? Because right now in Krita we just convert short stretches of pixels.
Yeah. I have omitted this here for simplicity. We have already talked about it, and I think I have in this image create call this very simple options, and later you get an in-memory structure, and this can you use to pass further options, to change options, and also to apply an what was it? To add an object which has inside some functions to use as callbacks for getting image regions, scan lines, and as well as single pixels. And if I get not much requests for tile-based images or for scan lines, I would simply like to omit this and make it very simple and just call for one pixel and then have a very simple design to also support images which are stored not in memory but on a file or somewhere else, and it should give some flexibility, I hope, for different needs. So, and well, this is all I have to say to Oranus currently, where going back. Where are also an API for named colors to make easy conversion, and I use it already in an application. And well, I have the Xcode inside to query and so on. But I think at the current stage this is now enough to get a basic understanding, I hope. Now to this scenery about how to use how to create a workflow with your real world application. This is about camera wall displaying, and in the first part, of course, your application has to import, to develop, to convert to RGB so as well camera data, and then with the first question. You ask the image and have to check is a profile assigned somehow. Well, I have here always the nose, it's more easily to show. And if you have this profile assigned, you can go to the Aramis image create step, and this is the target for all these other steps. And if you have no profile assigned to the image, you go to the next step and ask, is EXIF information included? And this EXIF information can be an sRGB profile or an Adobe profile. Possibly it doesn't match to every raw image. I'm not sure, I have not much to do with this especially, but this is the the order of using the most blown up color information, then use an less verbose information in the form of the EXIF tag. And if you have no image specific information, you can query it to a database where you ask for your device and your camera model, possibly you have a serial number of your model, and get a very specific profile for your image from there. If it does not help, your application hopefully asks for what to do next, and so it's the first step where user interaction comes in, and if the user decides, oh no, don't pop up anything, it passes to the next step. And if he says, oh, I care very much about what is happening, then a profile selecting dialog should be shown, and you get a profile selected by the user from there. For the automatic step in bypassing this dialog, you have to query in my Ivana-centric layout here to the library for the assumed RGB input profile. And then you surely have, in one of these many ways, get one profile for one image, and you use it as in the previous displayed scheme to create the image, to do the color conversion and run it, and then you can display your final content on screen. That's other direction. Well, and I have now also thought about how to get color management into Cairo. I'm not sure if we want to skip this because it's very specific, and I have yesterday talked about this to cover off. Is very interesting, interested about it? No? So I have, I could have outlined some answers to on how to bring all these colors in the most easily and most straightforward way to users and into applications. And I think I will now open for questions you have, and that's currently. So, do you have questions? Okay.
So, if I understood you correctly, for me, for working in Queens, my first step would be to get rid of our own column management with settings dialog and query the settings from the Orange library. I'm not really sure whether I should try to get rid of our direct dependency on LCMS. Because we use LCMS not just for color correcting the display and so on, but also for our color transformation filters.
That's a better question. I try to get the to show the API. Hope I get it big enough. I've stored this currently in an alpha called header file because it's not very stable currently. It's always changing. We're talking now about the future of what Ironis will be used like, and I'll try to find the color conversion. Object, and this is about the creation of the color conversion object. You can pass a profiles list, and this profile list will contain an arbitrary amount of profiles. So you have, of course, the input profile, you have then very many, let's see if I can find it here, where is count? As you have some very manipulating profiles. No, it is, I don't see. And these manipulation profiles are probably what you ask for. So you can chime it in, and also you have to specify the proofing profile, for instance. in, at this place, if you don't automatically get it from
someone else.
You haven't? Yes, you have.
Well, not like check whether things are out of debit for printing.
Yeah.
You can't view that yet.
No? Really? Oh. Yeah, it should be there, and the options is a little bit dependent on the as the option design is a little bit dependent on the GUI layout, so it's also not very settled down. But where you should tell, okay, my profile number 5 is the proofing profile, and the other profiles are.
That's what people will get from the control panel. That would be a good place to start.
Yeah. Okay. So I think we can finish here. May I take the chance to introduce to my following speaker? It is Thomas Karnecki. He is a Google Summer of Code student for this year and will implement Color Management near X, so it's the official title of this project. And he will tell us about how to get the whole desktop color management color managed for Linux based on his on OpenGL technology. It's a very interesting project, I think, where we get many things handled at once, which are otherwise very complicated to get. I'm really interested and glad that you can talk here about this. So we close and give it to you. To him, to me?
Yeah, I'm not sure if it's like.
Sorry?
We have all the questions afterwards. It might be something.
All right.
So I have a question about the formatting in the.
That's one. Yeah?
Yeah, so one of the goals is like predictability. And for like the color mappings, you have these different rendering intents, like perceptive and some of these, and they're very well defined what they do to when you transform between the color spaces.
Oh, they are somehow defined.
They're somehow defined, and tone mapping is something that is. Usually, on many algorithms, they are totally unpredictable. So I see a kind of conflict between the goal to have a very predictable workflow, because tone mapping is like, it's a bit similar in concept to what you do to the colors when converting from color spaces is what you do to the intensities when converting from like high dynamic range to low dynamic range. There's a conceptual similarity to some extent there.
I don't think so. I think ICC has defined the perceptual rendering intent, which is majorly a blessing rendering intent. You should get out when something which is dedicated to a good appearance, and you have not much constraints in it. It just should look good. And I think this is this fits very nicely to tone mapping. It should display the image in a way which is simply pressing or shows something meaningful.
But I doubt that you can do this by just having like a switch, having a perceptual mapping from high dynamic range to like whatever output device you have, and it will look like. Have the same kind of predictability that you have with this rendering intent, because the problem is much more complicated than the rendering intent.
Yes, of course, there must be introduced other options, like how to involve the viewing environment how to involve the device capabilities, for instance, the white points, the luminance, and so on. And I think certain tone mapping operators will implement a very precise thing that, so that you can do such things which you see in the advertisement. Often you have a screen standing somewhere and you have the background scene around it, and you think you look through the screen, and so you have a very identical mapping. It's currently with ICC very hard to get. And it's more a marketing thing. I think with such a framework of tone mapping and rendering according to the ICC, we will get it in a usable thing.
I'm quite skeptical because most tone mapping algorithms, they don't really care about the
most
completely mess up the colors.
I think most tone mapping operators work like perceptual. Perceptual is as well not precise. It's a very approximation. It's more art, and this art is very quite equal to most tone mapping operators you see. Of course.
I agree that it is kind of a similar concept, but I'm not sure if it will work out quite well in practice. That's my concern.
Yes, of course we
because
have
it's
to.
It's even more artistic, like this. Choices in the tone mapping are, I guess, more artistic than the choices you do with the rendering intents.
I think there are different things to get handled by the color management system. The one is the precise and the correctness. I think this one major concept point. The other is prediction and repeatability and. Hopefully over computers, so we have to also to interact with other operating system vendors to get it to get consensus about it, and with this consensus, it should be able to have the artistic feeling also on other computers in other environments mapped to other media and so on, and this is not necessarily an very exact and precise point of view. It's just about repeatability. And if we reach this, most people will be happy.
Maybe it's a bit related to having one document source and creating web page and print document out of it. It's like, but it's a hard problem and it's good to attack.
Yes, of course.
Hi, my name is Thomas, and this summer I will be working on a Summer of Code project. Kai is my mentor, and now I will tell you a bit about the current state of color management in X11, the Unix windowing system, and then a bit about my project, what it's about, and then what other possibilities there are once my project is. Or if my project is successful, which I hope. So let's start. XCMS, it's an X color management system. It was a first attempt to color management. It first appeared in 1991, which is way long before ICC was founded. So XCMS does not know about ICC profiles. It's a purely client-side library which you can use to create custom color maps. It has functions to convert colors, pixel values from one color space to another, but that's about it. It's part of the libx11 API. It's built into libx11. It's not a separate library. And basically nobody uses it. I've read that if any application tries to call any of the functions, it will crash. But it will not be removed. Well, because some applications might use it, and I've read the X11 developers do not want to remove it. So it will stay there just, but nobody's likely to use it. The problem is that there is no integration. The X server on the server side, the server side does not know about color management, about color spaces, profiles, nothing like that. Clients have to do the color transformation themselves. They usually use one of the available color management systems, like little CMS. And another problem is that there are no system-wide settings. Like if you use Krita and Inkscape, you are likely to have to configure both applications separately. So there is no center place like a GNOME or a KDE control center where you could configure the display device profiles and such things. In the past few years, there were new protocol, X11 protocol extensions developed, which are quite interesting. For example, the composite extension, which is used in a compositing manager. Then the GLX, corresponding GLX extension, which is also needed for a compositing manager. Then Render 1.2, which was released, which was already released, and 1.3, which will be released sometime in the future. Especially Render has some nice implications for color management, which we can use. Render means is the X resize, rotate, and reflect extension. And I won't go into detail because we don't have much time, but it splits the different configurations of a screen, the root window, the size, and the outputs, the different outputs the computer has. And you get events when any of the configuration changes. So you get an event if the user plugs a new display device in. And you can set output properties. Yeah, I don't have enough time to explain it, but it's really cool. Now the basic idea behind a composited desktop, if you are running Compass, what is actually happening? Compass redirects all windows into off-screen buffers, so the windows do not draw into the front buffer directly, but they render into off-screen buffers. And then the compositing manager takes these buffers, and using OpenGL, it renders them to the front buffer, and while it does that, it applies effects, 3D effects, alpha blending, transformation, any kind of, and you can basically use any of the OpenGL features, like shaders and textures and whatever there is. Well, some people think it's only eye candy for the desktop, which I don't agree with. It has some nice features like accessibility features like zoom, which is hard to implement in normal X, and invert colors, which is used for people who have not so good eyes, and there are color filters which can also be useful. However, it comes at the cost of an increased video memory consumption because you have to keep all the copies of the windows in off-screen memory. That is not a problem nowadays because computers come with a lot of memory nowadays. It requires recent hardware. Any Vista-capable hardware should run Compass fine, even older sometimes. And what was a problem was that X video overlays don't work anymore, or any kind of overlays don't work with compositing manager. However, that should be solved now in the drivers. My Google Summer of Code project is about bringing color management to the whole desktop, and without requiring explicit support in the applications. My plan is to use these new technologies I described earlier. The basic idea is to attach ICC profiles to Windows, or to let applications attach profiles to Windows, and then use Compositing Manager to apply color transformation. Now, Compositing Manager usually uses OpenGL to render, and OpenGL has shaders which can be really useful and are really fast. And there will be a possibility for applications to say, no, I do not want Compass to touch any of my pixels. I will do the color transformation myself. This is useful for professional graphics applications like Krita, GIMP. I have to limit the scope of my project, so I will focus on general desktop applications. Professional applications have different needs. They need per fragment color management and such. Then there is the problem of what happens if you plug in a new display device. Who manages the configuration? It should be ideally the user session, like GNOME session or such, or KDE session. And the preferences dialogs to integrate into the control centers. There is another Google Summer of Code project under OpenICC, which will create the KDE control center. Now to the implementation details. First, I will need to create an extension so that applications can attach the profiles to the windows. Basically, an extension comes in three parts. First is the wire protocol that defines the bits and bytes and structures that are sent between the clients and the server. Then the client-side library or API, which the client-side applications can use. And then the server-side implementation. There is a really cool project called XCB, the XC bindings. It started in 2001. Because there apparently was a really big mess how libx11 handles the network, the structures, and the whole network handling. XCB uses XML to describe the protocol, and the XML style sheets to automatically generate C code out of it. It currently used to generate client-side bindings only, but there are plans to extend it to the server side too. It's fully asynchronous, which is really cool. But it's a very thin layer. It's basically you operate on you send structures and receive replies, and that's all. The features I will need to have in my in the new extension is first to upload profiles to the server. Then let the application specify regions of a window and attach profiles to it. And then and functions to enumerate regions or get the regions and associated profiles, which will be used in the compositing manager. Another part of my project will be to create an OpenGL CMM color matching module. The plan is to use OpenGL to generate shaded code, which out of profiles. So if you have two profiles, the source and target profile, then you tell the Oranos OpenGL CMM to generate shaded code that will then transform colors from this source profile to target profile. It will be a CMM that is general, so that any application that wants to use it can use it. If Krita decides to that the computer has a really fast GPU, and they can use it. Then the last step will be to integrate Oranos into Compass. Compass is uses plugins for virtually any kind of functionality. So moving windows is a plugin, resizing windows is a plugin. I will create a new plugin that will do the color transformation. Then I will integrate the OpenGL shader code, generate the shader code, and apply the transformation based on the profiles. What else is possible if I finish this successfully? Then we could say, well, the X server gives us ARGB buffers. But we can say, well, this is not alpha, red, green, and blue, but this is just four channels which you can use. So for example, an application could take a CIE lab colors, break it into the three components, L, A, B, upload it into the X server, the L channel in the red channel, the A channel in the green channel, and the B channel in the blue channel. Then attach a profile, an ICC profile in the window, and the compositing manager would then automatically transform the colors to RGB. The Compass Video plugin already does that for YUV videos. The Compass plugin has a simple shader code that only implements YUV to RGB, but it works really well. Another issue is multi-monitor setups. If you like now, I have these are the very same pixels. There's only one frame buffer, but these pixels are sent to two different display devices. One is my screen here, one is the projector. Now, if I have, and these devices have different profiles. Now, it should be, now an application has to decide on which screen, on which display device, do I want to look the pixels correctly. Now, this decision should not be in the application, but the user should be able to do that. Using a menu like here we have move to another workspace. Maybe there would be a menu match colors to output VGA. And then the compositing manager would automatically apply the correct transformation to so that the pixels look correctly on the VGA output. Another thing is color filters. With Kai had the idea to add a third profile into the pipeline that would apply color transformation. One use case would be for the colorblind, so that if the colorblind can't distinguish shades of green and red, then the profile would transform these colors to something they can distinguish. There is already a color filter plugin for Compass. I haven't tried it, but yeah, if you have ICC profiles that you can use to describe the color transformation, it's much more flexible than the Compass plugin has just a few built-in filters. We've heard about the color transformation language. Maybe sometime in the future it will be possible to not use only ICC profiles, but also attach these blobs of color transformation language to Windows. Color transformation language looks almost like shaders, very similar. So it should be possible to translate between the color transformation language and OpenGL shaders. Yeah, that's about it. This is a Google Summer of Code project. My mentor is Kai Huberman. The organization is OpenICC. I have set up a blog which I will hopefully use to post updates. Here are some links which you might find useful. So, if there are any questions, you can ask them now if we have time, or then just grab me outside. I would really like to discuss the API and the concepts I use with the developers among you. If there is anything you want me to add or change, or if you see a use case for your application, please tell me so we can work something out. Thanks.
There are a lot of Windows manager, and it would be cool to be able to use your work in the other Windows manager.
I haven't really planned to. The code in the Compass plugin should be really easy because it's just fetch the profiles from the X server, and use Oranos to create the shaders and then apply the transformation. So it's, I don't think it's a good idea to put this kind of code into a library that any application can use, because it's easy enough so that any window manager can implement it. There are currently only two compositing managers I'm aware of. Three. Compass, Kwin has implemented compositing features, and Xcomp Manager, that's the original compositing manager.
Thanks. You said there's an opt-out for professional applications that are already doing color management.
Yes.
So do you, it seems to me the other half of opting out is you want to know what the, if there is an output profile for the device, you want to be able to get that so you can tell your own color management system what to do. Because otherwise you're outputting sort of essentially any color in.
Yeah.
So have you thought about how that could fit into the client API?
You mean how, for example, Krita could get the display device profile.
Yes, exactly.
I skipped the part about the XRender extension. Basically, the plan is to attach the profiles to the outputs here A, B, and C, and it's just a render property. It's a feature that's currently built into the X server. It's just a couple of X calls.
Okay. So you can ask the R&R extension what the output profile
is
for the device. Thanks. This is really exciting.
Thanks.